Guys, welcome back to Everything Mathematics, and this is our new week. It is also our new series. We're going to be starting our new series of geometry. And geometry, if I must say, is one of my favorite area in mathematics. I cannot even tell you in advance how many topics we're going to cover in this series, but let's see how deep the rabbit hole goes. What are we going to do today? As always, whenever we start in a new concept, we of course have to understand what that concept is all about, what that concept entails. And today we're going to look at understanding what geometry is all about. And last but not least, we're going to be defining some key terms, some key concepts all relevant to geometry. So let's start. Geometry. What is geometry? Geometry is basically a branch of mathematics which is concerned with properties and relations of points, lines, surfaces, solids, and higher dimensional analogs. Of course, as you go up the levels in mathematics, as you study from primary to secondary to tertiary and maybe even all the way to university, you will approach different levels of geometry. At the very lowest level, sometimes all we focus on is just shapes, plane surfaces, and maybe a little solids. You know, you'll get the cubes, the cubers, and so on. But as you go up higher in geometry, you will do things as a higher dimensional analogs. And these are things that maybe will take us a little to the abstract element of maths. But luckily for us, for CXC, we don't necessarily need to go there. Another thing we need to understand, and it's very important, although sometimes we take it for granted, but we must acknowledge some of the founding fathers or the founding fathers of geometry or the persons that geometry is attributed to. So firstly, we have Euclid, and I don't like to tell you, well, the first day I learned about this man, I appreciated maths even more. In mathematics, generally, everything could be proven, or at least that's what we boast in maths. If something can be done, then it could be proven. But this man here called Euclid, I can't even remember his second name. I should have searched up his second name. But I think it was called Euclid of Alexandria or something like that. He would have come up with 5 postulate axioms, quote unquote, that today, up to today, in mathematics, we accept it, but no one has ever proven why it is so. But we all acknowledge and accept that it is so. And in fact, most of the things that this guy here came up with, Euclid, in fact, is what we would say today, I mean, when you really pay attention, is what really laid the foundation for geometry. I recall 2 of them off heart, and I'll just share them with you. For example, he would have postulated that to draw a straight line or to draw a line segment, all we need is 2 points. So we have 2 points, we could draw a line segment. And we all know that to be true. And you might say, well, okay, what is in that to prove? That's a fact. Yes, it is a fact. But mathematicians to date cannot justify why this happened. And to us, it's like, okay, well, why we have to prove that? But that is mathematics. If it can be done, then it can be proven. But no one can prove none of the 5 postulates that Euclid would have come up with whenever he was existent or whenever he was alive or whenever. And another one that I like a lot that he came up out of the 5, I think there are 6 in all, maybe I should double check that too. But another postulate or axiom that he came up with is the fact, and again I say fact because we can't prove it, but we know it's true, that every right angle, according to that postulate, every right angle is the same. And it's like, you think about that and it's like, wow, yeah, in truth, it don't matter how you turn it. So you could have a triangle. This right angle here will be the same if you have a square. A right angle is a right angle. Even if you have a smaller triangle, guess what? This right angle is this right angle is this right angle. They are all the same. It don't matter if you have a big triangle. And don't mind my shape, I'm only sketching. It is still the same. It will still be 90 degrees. And that baffled a lot of mathematicians, but to hell, nobody could have proven this differently. So it's like we just accept it. It's like a fact laid by Euclid that we cannot deny, but at the same time, we cannot prove it. I mean, if you are a mathematics fan or lover like me, I would encourage you, go and check out the five postulates set aside by Euclid, which of course would have led to Euclidean geometry. And to date, no one has ever defined or proved why these axioms are like that. In fact, that reminds me of this other thing in maths. There are seven mathematical questions, I believe, in the world that has never been answered. And I think if you are able to answer one of them, you will earn $1 million or something like that. Yes, that's a true thing. I didn't plan to say that, but yeah, just as I came up with it, as I'm thinking about the postulates here and how it cannot be proven to be what it is, although we accept it for what it is, I remember those seven questions. Maybe we could look at those in one video. Obviously, I don't know the answer to, otherwise I definitely would have attempted them. But those are nice things to know. And of course, another set of people, in this case is not a person, but the second set of people to which geometry is attributed to, or they're considered to be the founding fathers of geometry, are those of the Egyptians. In fact, today, to date, many of the Egyptian architecture cannot be duplicated by any and anybody in the world. And imagine we're living in this quote-unquote advanced technological age. Yes, these Egyptian people, they're very good with their geometry. From the very early creation of the pyramids and the many things that they do today. It didn't just start today, of course, it started way back when. These people just had a grasp of geometry and they just built things, they understood things, they did things. And of course, you also have the Babylonians. I didn't put it here, but the Babylonians, they were also very good with geometry. And in fact, they were one of the first set of persons who the Pythagorean theory is attributed to. They were not able to define it for what it was, but the Babylonians understood the concept of the Pythagoras theorem, basically, and they were able to use it in constructions, architecture, and written geometry, and so on and so forth. Yeah, man, give credit to where credit is due. And of course, today, as you know, geometry and entails all these things. Building, construction, architecture, archaeology, everything stems down to geometry. So let's not take this definition lightly, because that is really the bottom line of geometry. Relationships between points, lines, surfaces, solids, and higher dimensional analogs. Everything we do under geometry will relate to all these key points that I just mentioned here. And that is why we're going to look at those key terms. So these are the key concepts when it comes to geometry. These are things that we just need to understand innately or without thinking twice. So let's quickly go through these definitions and we're going to build from there as we dip deeper and deeper into geometry. So let's go. What is a point? Well, everything is laid on here for us. A point is basically a location in space or a dot or a coordinate location. That is basically a point. And for the coordinate location, if I must be more exact, and again, we're going to go more in depth as we dip deeper, a coordinate is made up of an X and a Y coordinate. So if you plot, and excuse my grammar, my language, if we don't have this technical understanding, then some of the words I might be using here might lose you. But plotting here simply speaks about finding the location of a coordinate, right? A coordinate is made of a Y value and an X value. When we plot one coordinate, we also have what we consider to be a point. So that's what we mean here when we say a coordinate location. A coordinate location is when you point at, when you plot an X and Y value in a Cartesian plane, you will get a point. Or simply again, a location in space or a dot. A line is a series of connected dots or points that runs indefinitely in both directions. So as I usually tell my students, a line is not something that you could draw. It's not something that you could write. You could try all you want. It's impossible. However, you could represent a line on paper. For example, if you have this line, this is the symbol, and don't mind, this is supposed to be straight. I'm sketching here. This is a representation of a line. We could draw the representation of a line, but it is impossible to draw a line in real life because, again, as the definition implies, a series of connected dots that runs indefinitely on both sides. So this line here will go forever this way, and this point here will go forever that way. However, what we could draw on a page is a line segment. And a line segment, as defined here, is a part of a line that has two endpoints. And that is a line. That is what we are custom calling rather a line. This is a line segment, but I know we usually call this a line. And that's okay. I think most teachers understand and they accept it. But this now, when we draw this on a page, this is what actually what we have. What we have is actually a line segment. And some persons, they label it. They put a point here and they put a point here. Or they might say A, B. Good. But that's our line segment because it has two endpoints. Moving on swiftly, then we have array, and I think everybody also knows what is array. Array is a part of a line that has one endpoint. And again, array, we could draw a representation, but we cannot really, draw it. So we have array like this. So one side goes on forever, and another side stays. It has an endpoint. So part of a line that has one endpoint. So here we have our endpoint at this point here, and at this point here, we go forever. That will never stop. And last but not least, oh, and by the way, if I might just show it out, because we will address all this later down the line as we deep into geometry, array is also what we use later down the line called a vector. So a vector is usually represented by array, and you will learn that as we progress. And a plane, we're going to stop at this last point here because that's another thing that we'll be playing with a lot. Well, in the next video, I think we'll be doing plane surfaces, plane shapes. So we're going to discuss a plane even further. But a plane is basically a flat surface, an indefinite flat area. And we have to start appreciating a plane is abstract. A plane is something that runs forever on a given surface. One of the best ways to represent a plane, as I usually tell my students, is like they could think of the surface of a table. Imagine you have a table in your house. I think everybody knows what a table looks like. You have a table. The surface of the table is what we will consider a plane. But it does not stop at the surface of your table. It extends beyond your edges and the edges of your table. So for instance, if I go to draw a generic table here, let's suppose that's my table here. Picture these two things here as the leg and this surface here. So this is the top of the table. Let's consider this as the top of the table. So we say now that the top of the table is what we consider a plane. But this is a physical plane, the one that we could see. But a plane surface, it will extend. It goes on forever in that direction. Even though we cannot see, or even though the tabletop is not here, as I'm writing here, even though the tabletop is not here, this level here, as long as it's in line with the top of the table, this here is a plane. There are many planes that exist on different dimensions, and that is something we need to understand. There is also a plane that runs here. There is a plane that runs on that level, so we could think of that as another plane. There's another plane that could run like this. So this plane goes on backwards and forwards. Let me see if I could try and represent this in a different way. Another way you could maybe try, it's very abstract. It's very abstract. But one of the ways we could see it maybe is through a 3D representation. So we know generally we have this. This is what we consider the Cartesian plane, let's say. So we have our this is our y-axis, allow me to abbreviate, and then we have our x-axis. But then when we're dealing with planes, we have to understand that there is a three-dimensional, we're living in a three-dimensional world. Man, this line coming not so crooked. We live in a three-dimensional world. So there is this third plane here. Let's call it Z, right? So what we need to understand here, I hope you see my 3D, I hope you can see the 3D effect. So all this here is a plane. This we call the Z plane. That's the Z plane. Yes? Then guess what? The Y itself, call that a vertical plane. The Y forms a plane for itself. And then we have the X forming its own plane. So it might be abstract. It is abstract, as a matter of fact. So even if you don't understand this, it's totally understandable. But we need to understand that planes exist on the what we could see and on what we cannot see. And what is a plane really and truly? It's a flat surface area. It's an indefinite flat area. Hopefully, as we dig deeper into geometry, those definitions will come into life and you will see them, because I will be related to them a lot. So for today, again, let's call that the end of today's video. Always, as always, like, share, subscribe if you haven't done so as yet. Leave a comment in the comment section and turn on that notification, of course, if you want to be alerted when the next one comes out tomorrow, God's willing. So until then, you take care. Enjoy the rest of your day.